talks. The first speaker is Thorsten Leemhuis, who was a former Fedora contributor back in Fedora Extras, and now is an editor who writes technical articles in Germany.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Your turn.
Is the mic still working properly? Can you hear me up there? He's concentrated. Can you hear me? Seems so. Nobody complains. So let's get started. Yeah, quick, who am I? I'm working as an editor or a writer for a German publishing company. Those from Germany might know it. It's CT magazine. It's also having an online publication that's called Heise Open. We used to have a subdivision in London that translated lots of our stuff. That's maybe where some of you know me. It's the Kernel-Land that was published on DH. Sadly, half a year it was closed down, and actually even worse, a few weeks ago, they even closed the site, so you can't even get all those articles that I wrote. I'm also a Fedora contributor since the early days. If you want to know what I have been doing like 5 or 10 years ago, look up in the Fedora wiki. And for the newcomers of you that are contributing to Fedora, we had badges back then too, at least kind of badges. They looked like that, and you can put them in somewhere where they look good. I still have it, but it's these days it's really a badge marathon that what some Fedora guys do. I'm not contributing much to Fedora these days anymore. I sometimes show up on the mailing list and to ask stupid questions and annoy people maybe. What I'm actually doing is maintaining a repository for Fedora where you can get vanilla kernels. So if you have a problem with the Fedora kernel, you can go and get kernels from this repository and install them to check if the problem shows up with a vanilla kernel, so unpatched. And you can go to the kernel developers upstream to check to report your bug in that case. What I'm not is a kernel developer. As I said, I'm just a writer. There are people in this room who are kernel developers, so they will know more about the talks, some of the things I'll talk about than I. So if you are one of those, feel free to interrupt me. If you want to correct me, that should help everyone. The good thing as a writer is I'm having a really broad overview, and broad overview is what you get here. As you can see, we're just 3 minutes in. I'm also at already at slide 20. That will continue in this pace. So I hope that it's not too fast for everyone. A quick, what you get here is four topics, things recently happened in the kernels that are released recently or coming up in a few weeks, important developments over the past year, a little bit on the development process, if there's time, and some things that are that people are working on and challenges that are likely coming up in the next few months or maybe the next year. So let's go to the features recently added. This will be mostly about Linux 3.13 and 14. 3.13 was released in mid-January. It will likely soon hit Fedora 20 as a regular update, Fedora 19, I suppose, as well. It will also be used in Ubuntu 14.04, the next LTS release that's coming in April. Yeah. One of the biggest features that got a lot of attention that was added to 3.13 is NF tables. It's a new package filter subsystem that's expected to replace the IP tables code in the kernel, not only IP tables, but also IPsix tables, ARP tables, EB tables. So the stuff you use when you're setting up a firewall. The big difference is it's protocol independent. In fact, the NF table stuff in the kernel is a small VM, for the lack of a better term, that interprets some code that is handed into the kernel by a user space tool that's called NFT. So all the protocol support for the different protocols like IPv4, IP V6 is in that tool. That makes the kernel design a lot easier, and updating the tool is easier than updating the kernel. And it offers some features that were not possible with the old stuff that's in the kernel as well. The thing is, the NFT's syntax is different from IP tables, so you have to kind of create new rule sets for NFT and NF tables. But the thing is, there is an NFT compatible versions of IP tables and IP6 tables around, which understand the old syntax, so you can use those tools to feed to use NF tables subsystem in the kernel and still use your old rule set. One word of a warning, NFT and NF tables are in the kernel, similar like ButterFS, but they are not production ready yet. It will take some time to get them production ready. Remains to be seen how long that will take. Don't think it will be years, but I guess a year or something it will take. Another new important addition to 3.13 is block MQ. That's short for multi-queue block I/O queuing mechanism. That sounds a bit complicated, and actually is. In the end, it's using multiple threads when talking to storage hardware. So the work is actually spread on different CPU cores, and that is actually needed to get proper performance out of really fast storage devices. Really fast storage devices are not ordinary SSDs. It's even faster SSDs like the ones that are in a PCIe slot or something, or even quicker devices that will show up in the next few months or years. It should somewhat help ordinary storage as well. Remains to be seen how fast it is, because right now the only driver that uses this multi-queue stuff is a vid.io block. That's something that's used when you do KVM virtualization normally to talk to the host. A few more details will be available at 11:30 in the talk, persistent memory, what changes when DRAM is all we need. That's Rick here. It's just a side topic there, I think, but it will be mentioned. The Radeon driver for the AMD cards is also something that improved a lot in 3.13. There are a lot of different things that got improved. Performance got way bigger on the recent cards. HDMI audio is now enabled by default, and DPM, that's a power management technique, is also enabled by default. Habai GPUs are supported that are recently released Radeon GPUs, so you can support drive them also. And secondary GPU power down support, that's if you're having a laptop with a APU from AMD and a dedicated graphics card in addition in your laptop, the kernel can now power down the dedicated GPU to save power. Another important feature that got added to 3.13 is balance numer. That's something for the server guys among you. That's better process and memory placement in numer systems. Numer systems are those systems you have in server these days. If you have multiple sockets, you have memory banks normally connected to each CPU sockets, so if you're talking, if your process runs on CPU 0 and uses memory that's connected to CPU 1, then that memory is not that fast reachable than if you would be using memory on your directly connected to CPU 0. So that helps performance, can even bring quite a lot performance. This will be in RHEL 7. That's of interest for anybody, and details about that were yesterday told in the talk about NUMA-aware scheduling. I guess that the video from that talk will be available on YouTube in a few days. So what else? 3.13 got a whole other stuff, improvements to make SquashFS quicker. That's the stuff you use on the live CDs. Huge pages, that's something you use in KVM virtualization. I got also some corner cases sorted out that could in the performance. Random number generator was also improved, and lots of new and enhanced drivers were added, just like every kernel. If you want more details about all that, those to Germans, if you can look on Heise Open. If you're speaking English, LWN and Kernel Newbies have all the details. That was 3.13. Now let's go to 3.14. That's under development right now. The main work on of development is done already. It's now in this testing stabilization phase. That's why I can already talk about what's coming in that kernel version. It's actually expected late March. And normally they are just it's pretty reliable. Maybe a week or earlier or one or two weeks later is possible, but late March should do it. One of the features added there is deadline scheduling. That's not a different scheduler. It's actually an extension class for the regular CFS scheduler. And that supports earliest deadline first. That's a scheduling mechanism of interest for the real-time. Because in real-time system, it can make reliable sure that tasks are started early enough to have enough time to work, get their work done before there's a deadline. So that's basically what you really need on real-time systems. And the trick there is the task has to tell the scheduler how long it normally runs, how often it's called, and when the deadline actually is. And that way the scheduler can really make sure that the task gets their work done. Another feature added to 3.14 is KASLR. That's short for Kernel Address Space Layout Randomization. That's something you had in the user space for quite a while already. It shuffles around some of the function pointers in on every boot. But this time it doesn't do it for user space programs, it does it for kernel internal functions. So that is just like the user space solution is supposed to make life harder for attackers and malwares. So they can't easily find a function in the kernel to gain more permissions. It's actually started now. It's not, they are actually considering to improve that, but it's a start. 3.14 will also bring TCP auto-corking. That's a technique to delay small transmission a little while. That's in the hope that more data supposed to transmit it is coming, is floating in, and then to package the small data with from the beginning with the other data into a bigger package that's supposed to reduce the overhead for the local system and also makes transferring the data easier for the network, so it also reduces the overhead for the network infrastructure. For those still interested in Xen, 3.40 will give something that's called Xen HPV. That's a bit like Xen PV, so Xen para-virtualization of thing Xen actually was famous for or got famous with in the beginning. That's where you have to have the Xen support in the guest operating system, and so you don't have to emulate a full PC hardware. So the guest system and the hypervisor talk more directly with each other. That was needed when the CPUs didn't have virtualization extensions. They have those now, and Xen HPV is actually using some of those virtualization features in modern CPUs to make the PV mode a little bit quicker. Remains to be seen if there's interest in that in the market. What else? Time is ticking. Could talk a lot about all those things. So DPM, that's the power management feature for Radeon cards, is now supported even on the newest generation. There's support for the next generation Intel hardware coming 3.14. There's a driver for the box display interface. That's what QMU normally emulates if you enable VGA support. There's KXX support for UEFI. So if to reboot the system with while presenting the firmware to make rebooting quicker, or to actually look at the kernel that was crashed to, together with kdump, and debug why it's crashed. There's also REPL support in Perf. Perf is a performance monitoring tool, and REPL is in some internal stuff in the latest generation Intel CPUs. So with that, you can check how many, what the power your CPU took while running an application. That's not even all. There's also a heavy filter, a heavy hitter filter in 3.14. That's something extension to the network subsystem to make bulk transmissions not to reduce their priority a little bit, to make sure smaller transmissions get through the network. That's supposed to reduce the latency for if you're browsing the web and downloading something big in parallel. That should help that situation to make browsing still quick. The other stuff I'm skipping right now. So that was 3.13 and 3.14. Now to some developments over the past year. ButterFS gained quite a new features over the past year. It was RAID 5 and 6 support. Offline deduplication, offline is a bit not the right word, but let's leave it at that for now. Send and receive, that's interest for backup. I'm doing that a little bit quickly. It's still experimental, and but it seems to slowly mature, and a lot of the important stuff they wanted to work on with ButterFS is now in the kernel, and the feature work seems to slow down. If you want to know more about that, simply stay in the room. Lucas here will talk about it at 10 before 10 later, and I guess he will talk way more about it. Okay. Yeah. X4 and XFS you will likely talk about as well. It's the quick story is it gets slowly and carefully improved. The big news kind of is XFS gets a little more attention these days. It's becoming default file system in RHEL 7. One thing I like to mention normally when talking about file systems is back like 5 years ago, everybody said XFS is for big file systems. That's what everybody says today as well. But what were big file systems 5 or 10 years ago is not that big these days. So XFS is of more interest, I think, than 5 years ago. Storage is also something where a lot of happening, where there's SSD caching. Was merged into the kernel. There are two solutions. It's actually DM cache, and B in 3.9 and B cache in 2.10. SSD caching is you have an ordinary hard disk, and kind of you, like in RAID, you put an SSD, attach an SSD to it, and all those data you need most is transferred or stored only on the SSD to make sure. Everything needed a lot is quicker accessible or on the SSD. It's not real in Fedora, Anaconda is not yet properly supported, but all the tools are available. I think yeah, meant to be seen which of those solutions takes off. Maybe they are a bit different. So depending on this on your situation, one or the other might be better. Container is also something where a lot has happened, not only over the past year, or more over the past few years. But in the end, Linux finally now has everything for proper container virtualization. And you can notice that already because container are already supported for a while in SUSE Linux 11 since Service Pack 2. That's like 2 years already. RHEL until now had it as technology preview only container support, but RHEL 7, as far as I know, will officially support it. Container are used in Docker. That was maybe a few of you were there yesterday. Otherwise, take a look at the talk on YouTube later. That's explaining what this container virtualization is of interest. among the features the kernel gained over the past year, but nobody noticed that much, is support for checkpoint restart in user space. That's something where a user space tool talks to the kernel and analyzes a process, what it's using, and then practically can freeze the process and all the and move it to a different machine and restart there. That is supposed to work quite well with most applications. There are some corner cases. If your application is doing something really odd, then it won't work, but it should work. So if you're a high availability or a web hoster, then you can quickly move your processes from one machine to the other if you don't want to do maintenance on the first machine and move them back later. Container is a really broad topic. There are some security stuff related to it. There are user namespaces. You can learn about those today at 3:40 in secure Linux containers. I think that's Dan Walsh giving a talk. He's doing good talks normally, so I guess it will be a nice talk to go to. If you even want more details, you can go to second filtering at 2 o'clock, 10 past 2 this afternoon, and that's for Cisco filtering. So if you have a container or an application you want to sandbox a little bit, that's not the, all of it, then that talk might be of interest to you. Tracing and performance monitoring is also something that's improved quite a lot over the past year, or past few years. Ftrace and especially the Perf userland tool gained quite a lot of features over the time, and you can do a lot of things with them. It's a little bit complicated, so you have to take your time to learn it. If you want to go that direction, go to this talk at 10:40 tomorrow, Perf profiling. Jiri is, I guess, will be giving an overview of what's possible with the kernel these days to check how to use it to monitor the kernel and userland processes, what they are doing, and where why they are maybe slow or something. GPU drivers for those using Linux on your desktops, it's also important. For Intel, there's not much to say. Without going too much into detail, it's a steady process. Everything is good. There are a few things where things, a few areas where things could be better, but in the end, there's not too much to complain. AMD, I mentioned it earlier already with the Radeon cards. It's not perfect, not perfect, but the AMD developers caught up a lot. A lot of things work now. UVD, that's video decoder, is now possible to use. TPM, the power management things, work now, and support for latest generation Radeon GPUs is also now in the kernel after it has been lacking for like one year or 2 years. It was really bad, but now everything is there and should simply work. So in a lot of cases, you might not even need the proprietary drivers for AMD anymore. If you want good performance for playing games, then you actually need them, because that's an area where the open source drivers still lack. But just for the latest generation GPUs, if you have like 4,000, 5,000, or 5,000 series, then you get a lot of performance out of those, also with the free drivers. Nouveau, and the open source driver for NVIDIA cards, is not in that good shape. It works on quite a lot of systems, doing installation and actually even on desktop use. But there are a lot of things to hope for. At least we got finally fan management on a lot of newer cards now. But performance really is awful compared to the proprietary drivers. So, and that's just one of the things that are not working that well with Nouveau. So, yeah, but things slowly seem to improve since fall. NVIDIA provided some docs to the Nouveau developers and offered offered an email address where the Nouveau driver developers can answer questions if they have have them. That helped a lot to make Nouveau drivers a little bit better already. And it seems it's more is coming because NVIDIA 1 week ago started to contribute patches to Nouveau. And that's brand new. That should make the Nouveau drivers better also, but don't get excited too much. That was just to make the GPU and the Tegra K1 work. Tegra K1 is a SoC chip, so for tablets and smartphones. And its GPU is similar to the desktop GPUs that are around now. So they want to just, their interest is to make the install experience better. And there will remain a proprietary driver for the ordinary cards as well. And one of the big issues I mentioned, the performance already, the reason for that is the Nouveau drivers don't have much information how to change the clock from the GPU and the memory on the graphics cards. And that's something where NVIDIA don't provide them any help, even with the email address I mentioned earlier. They don't answer questions in that area, so power management and lack of 3D performance will remain a problem for Nouveau drivers for the foreseeable future. What else is cooking in GPU drivers? That is Prime and hybrid graphics support. So if you have an Optimus laptop with as I said, integrated CPU and dedicated CPU. So until now, and Linux doesn't support those combinations too good. Normally, you couldn't use the dedicated GPU on Linux. There were some tricks like Bumblebee to make it work, but you had to configure a lot, and that was quite hard and easily broke. And the kernel and the X server now supports some of that right from the start. So that is supposed to get better slowly. Another area where a lot of things are cooking is OpenCL support. So to use your GPU for computing, but that's mostly in Mesa and not outside of the kernel. Networking is also where a lot of things improved. I have a few things here like TCP fast open, that's to make HTTP connections a bit quicker. Low latency polling, if you really need low latency for your Ethernet devices, and a few other things. That's all these and other things that were added to the kernel over the past 1 or 2 years. Not something big, but people still find a lot of things to improve, and it seems that will continue for a while. ARM support also, that was in use a lot like 2 years ago. There were some process issues that the ARM developers didn't work too well with other kernel developers, and those got fixed. ARM is really working smoothly now. And the companies around in the ARM space support work together way more closely now. ARM 64 got mods, so 64-bit support for the latest ARM processors that offer it. That's important for the server space. Remains to be seen. There's still a lot of development going on, and what's actually of interest is multi-platform support for ARM. So that makes it possible to have one kernel that boots on a lot of different ARM platforms. So if you have a BeagleBone or you can boot a kernel there and on 10 or 20 other different platforms. That wasn't like that in the past. Back then you had to basically compile your kernel for one platform and you couldn't do booting on other platforms. So that makes it possible makes it way easier for Linux distributions because they have just, like in the x86 space, to build just one kernel and it runs on a lot of different machines. Okay. 10 minutes already? Oh yeah, then let's get little bit up to speed. Then I skipped the development process. If you're interested in that, or I'm going to only the quick things, it's new kernel versions these days come out around about every 9 weeks now. So basically every 2 months, that's 1 week less than about a year ago. So kernel development sped up a little bit. That's in those 2 months, round about the new kernel versions get added about 11,000 commits. That number slowly goes up as well. If you're interested in some stats, who's contributing and where people live and which companies do that, then go simply to LWN, going a bit quick over that, those years, over those now. LWN has, for example, analyzed where people live and which companies contribute a lot. There's this article, or if you want more details, go to LCE talk from Jonathan Corbett. It's available on YouTube. That's the changing of the Linux kernel development process. It's quite of interest if you really want to know who's sponsoring the kernel work and to if people get older and if new people come in and all that stuff. A few things that are under development for the kernel is KDBus. That's a high-level and in-kernel inter-process communication bus designed to replace DBus. This was in the news quite a lot. If you want to know more about that, go at 10:40 to the KDBus talk here that Leonard Pöttering giving. Union mounting is something where you can layer two different file systems on each other. That's of interest for containers and Docker, embedded live media, and many other areas. Interestingly enough, that's something the kernel lacks for more than 15 years now. And there's still not something foreseeable when the kernel will something offer to do that. Until now, a lot of distributions always patch in some solutions that are not up to the quality the kernel developers expect. Maybe something will develop over the next 1 or 2 years. Union mounts and overlay S are the main contenders in that space. They are around for some time already, and it looked like overlay FS would make it into 3.10, but then that didn't happen, and since then everything got quiet again. So that's kind of a never-ending story. Storage is also something where a lot of happening, where there are, for example, the shingled magnetic recording. That's a technique for hard disk to get more space on the platters of the hard disk. They use a trick that the operating systems in the ideal world should know about and operate specifically to that. That's something where the kernel needs a few changes. What also needed some changes is NVM devices, persistent memory. I'm not going into that too much because the time is running, and there's also a talk from Rick I mentioned earlier again. He will talk about that quite a lot. Graphics, what's cooking there? There's Virtual 3D, that's an experimental project that might allow quick and OpenGL support in local VMs, but that's still in the early stages, remains to be seen when it gets into the kernel, Mesa, Xorg, or Wayland, wherever it needs on different levels, and when it's in the distributions to actually get used without fiddling with all the stuff. Tracing perf is also where a lot of is happening. I mentioned it already. What's coming there is KTAP is a script-based dynamic tracing tool similar to what some of the of DTrace and SystemTAP offer. That makes it quite easier to probe something in the kernel. It was in the kernel for a quick moment already, but it is in the work. To get properly supported, and it will take, I guess, a few months. real-time, for those interested there, since a lot of years the real-time developer is done outside the kernel. They got a lot of patches needed to support proper real-time environments, or things need for real-time into the kernel. But a lot more, there's still some work to be done, and it's not really foreseeable how long it takes. Mainlining Android, the situation is similar. There are a lot of people that work on integrating patches, kernel patches that are used in Android kernels into the kernel, or working on proper solutions for the stuff Android needs. A lot of process has been made, but a lot more work is needed. What else? I could talk for 2 hours, I guess, about all the stuff. There's, for example, VFS hot data tracking, where can someone is working on a similar to SSD caching, where you simply put the files that are used mostly on an SSD that works on a different level than the SSD caching I mentioned earlier. And the simple FB is a new graphics driver that might replace some of the things we have in the kernel now, that together with a few other improvements might make the boot process more prettier, so it looks a bit more like Macintosh booting or OS X. Memory power management is also something a few people are working on. Multipass TCP, where you can get over different connections to the internet, is also something. What not to expect is an XFAT driver in the kernel. XFAT is the stuff you use on some video recording devices. It's a kind of successor for FAT, but it's a lot of patents involved, so just use the fuse driver. So with that, I'm getting to the end just in time. Just a word from the organizers. They want feedback and have a feedback URL in the schedule. You can find it there. Also, if you tell me how you like this talk, so I can improve it if I give it again. Here are some details, and if there are questions, I guess we have a minute or two for questions. If anybody has some, it was quite a lot. I hope I didn't talk you into sleep. Actually, the thing is, KLSLR is in 3.14. I didn't take that closer look, but there is a blog post from Keith Cook, I think, where he explains that, and I think they were talking about it. Sorry, I have to point you there, Google for it, and I guess you will find something. Anybody else? Seems not, then thanks for your attention. Enjoy the conference.